total truth time, pinky swear, truth or dare. Have you ever, as a child, maybe you're 10, 11, 12?
Yeah, yeah.
That deal.
A 30 to 40 year old man.
That, no, that deal where you lean back, you. And you spit straight up.
And catch it in your mouth. No.
Never? Mm-mm. Mm, that's the difference between you and me.
Oh! Let's start this thing! OMG, WTF, LOL, BBQ. Hello, beautiful people. It's Brian Brushwood live in Austin, Texas. And guess what? It is Tuesday night, which means it has got to be go time for Night Attack. Bringing you the best of the worst of the internet ever since anyone was counting. That's and that goes all the way back to Grognak of the Cuthar tribe. But nobody wrote it down, so it doesn't count. It, what matters is that Justin Robert Young is joining us all the way from Oakland, California, where we just had our, I would say, fairly successful live Night Attack performance.
Great performance. Everybody loved it. We had a huge audience. Everybody came from far and wide. Great times. Can we get back to Grognak of the Cthulhu tribe?
Oh, yeah, dude. He was the first two-star paint. We were there. You remember? That was our first show.
Yeah. It was, all right. So, geez, time machine.
I mean, at the time, we were inhabiting a snake and another snake.
We were. I was in the rear. Brian was in the front. And I would take Brian's cue. This is how we always knew. Brian would open the head of the snake, and what would you say? What was, I can't remember the exact wording.
I would say, it's comedy times, which was really forced because I had to put the extra S's in there.
And then I would just shake the rattler.
and then we got clubbed. Not very popular.
Who at the time was having... I mean, I don't want to get into it. You know, I mean, he was having very personal problems, right?
Wait, who, me?
Cthulhu.
Oh, no, Cthulhu. Okay, first of all, Cthulhu was, let's tell the truth. Cthulhu was our first uber fan, our first groupie.
Loved it.
Can I say our first psycho fan? Like, it was not cool. Cthulhu took it to levels that were inappropriate.
I mean, because it starts out great. Hey, man, I love you guys. I love it's comedy times. And, like, I know it's forced, but I'm totally into it. I love your imperfection.
Well, plus, also, I mean, let's... All right, I think you're dressing it up a bit. Cthulhu, if I remember him, was about, like, me. Snake. That's right?
That was more what it was. I mean, this is what I was hearing in my head because, I mean, it was a different time, right? It was a different time. But I remember there was one moment when Cthulhu... You know, just looks at us and says,
snake butt.
Yeah. Well, that was the moment. That was the moment. Yeah. He goes, snake, butt Cthulhu.
Yeah.
And it was, and he made a fist motion with two intertwining fingers. And we realized he wanted a three-way.
Initially, I thought he was just complimenting me because I was the snake butt. And I'm like, hey, man, listen, we all got a role to play. It's a team effort. Turns out he was requesting that we shoved the snake.
Our snake bodies inside and sort of. And then he said, and this is before the Macarena was a thing, but he interlaced his hands up to show that we should swim upward in his colon. And then he started, you know, doing this shit. And God damn it, I just won the belt. Fuck. It's fine. Doesn't matter.
I was so hoping we'd have an ending to that bit.
And we do.
My glory.
Brian won the belt. Hey, man,
welcome,
how you
everybody.
Doing?
Tonight Attack. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a hell of a show for you tonight. Number one, one of the people that has brought to you easily one of the best reviewed video games of the year, Uncharted 4, our old pal, Rob Krekel. He is our friend, first and foremost. Secondarily, he works at Naughty Dog and creates interactive art that delights the worldwide. He will join us. But Ryan, we wanted to start off because, well... The internet is a messy place wherein the bumper cars of life continually run into each other, and you had a situation this week.
It's not even so much a messy
place, so much as a confusing place. And that's one of the things I love about the internet. Okay, I want to take you inside a very strange experience, partly because
Like Cthulhu. Cthulhu wanted to take it inside.
Let us give you the experience Cthulhu always wanted.
For the audio listeners, what we're doing is just kind of like voguing our hands back and forth like two fishes swimming intertwined. Have you seen us at a live event or at DragonCon, whatever? If you just come and do that hand gesture to us, we will know exactly.
Long before there was the Diamond Club, there was the snake parade.
Cthulhu's put two of them in my butt.
So I want to be totally clear that I only want to share this experience because I'm genuinely confused as to how to react. It's like, you think you know the internet, you hop on there, you do your silly horse parade, you do your Cthulhu dance for 10 years, and then all of a sudden the internet throws you a fast one. You're like, huh, I guess you got me again, internet.
So it was, some young punk on the make. You know, you were like Omar, just going to get some snacks at the local deli, and next thing you know, some young upstart, some City of God stuff, just gives you the what for?
Okay, real quick, that pause, was that the pause of deciding whether or not you were going to give a fifth season spoiler to the Wire, just out to everyone?
I mean, I don't know, whatever. Oh my God.
That's fine, that's fine. Yeah, okay, all right. So, to set the scene, you guys know that we're very excited about scamstuff.com. We keep trying to come up with new stuff or whatever. And there was something that we found. We didn't create it. We just found them, and I guess 3 years ago, the store's not even that old, but we bought like all there was, like 30 or 40 of them, and they sold out instantly, and then they were discontinued, and we're like, crap, they're not around anymore, right? And then John happens to find that they're available again, and we called it the lockproof pen, and it's pretty badass. This was every so often I feel like we come up with a good sales pitch, and separately a good video gets made, and it happens to be something that resonates with the audience. This is one of those cases where we just felt like we knocked it out of the park. I was so proud of it or whatever, and then I start getting tweets.
Well, all right, hold on, wait. Let's just look at this product real quick. I just want to take a look and just.
Sure.
I'm going to tell you that looks
Cthulhu's dream come true.
It looks as if it is one snakehead away from being Cthulhu's dream.
Look,
it can smash a pane of glass.
It's aircraft grade aluminum. It's a pen, and on one hand, it's got a glass shattering thing, and you see those as safety devices all the time. The other type has a crenulated crown or whatever. The idea being that if you get in a fight, you can jab and end up collecting some DNA, and if you untwist it, it's got a set of freaking lockpicks in there, right? So it's like plus it takes standard. High-end cartridges. Sounds like an ad because I'm quoting from the ad.
Importantly, it's a functioning pen.
It's a good pen too, right?
Right? You can write words, contracts. You can draw a penis.
Sure.
You can draw the president.
So we want
whatever you want. It's a functioning pen. I just want to let everybody know it's a pen, folks.
It's a pen. It's a really good pen. Now, there are pens that are $100, $99, $199. Say one of those. This one's a working man's pen.
I feel like I was going into Dana Carvey's Regis Philbin, like, it's a pen. I'm just saying it's a pen. Everybody go get the pen. It's a great pen.
So
I saw one for 10 grand that I want.
Wait, you saw a pen for 10 grand and you want it?
It was made out of amethysts. It was
Bonnie the Invisible Wife joining us. Welcome to the program. But I'm going to ask you this, Bonnie, this amethyst pen of yours.
Yes.
Yeah, can it also pick a lock?
No!
Okay! So now we've established that the value proposition of this $40 item is that it is A, a pen, and B, that it pick locks. And to take away either of them would make it a significantly lesser product if it were just a set of lockpicks or just a pen.
And plus also it comes with a tactical flashlight or whatever. Anyway, we're really, really proud of it. But then I catch word that like the number one lockpicking YouTube channel posted a
kids,
review.
Those skateboarding kids always make the cockpit channels. They're just out there, like, putting their hats on backwards, saying, hey, you better Snapchat my yik yak because I'm gotta, I got a lock pick for you.
That's what they always do. So, all right, if we can, it was very confusing because I got tweets saying, like, hey, man, how do you answer this video? I was like, and answer what? And first of all, sometimes... You know, there's some stuff that you can source from different places, and they're lockpick related, and people think, you know, that it's like, oh, well, this is, I saw it in your site, so it's your thing. And oftentimes that may or may not be the case. So, but in this case, I go, and the first thing I see is it says, review, Scam Stuff's lockproof pen. And I think to myself, oh, damn. Because I already won the belt, I'll say, oh, shit, motherfucker. Cunt punch, hobo. This is
going against the spirit of the belt.
No, okay.
Yeah, really? Like, you just set fire to the belt.
I'm just saying, I have it right now. I'm gonna use it while I got it.
It doesn't get bigger the more you.
By the end of the segment, it's literally going to be Brian as Atlas, like carrying the belt across the back while he scoops the C-word.
So I was very excited, and I was very confused because
it's about time these kids respected their elders. I haven't even seen this. These kids, come on.
Bonnie hasn't seen it either. Here, let's take a look. You could probably skip to like 20 seconds in or so because he has a pretty epic intro. But
same thing about the
flag. And then this is the thing, right?
You will find your pen. It's aluminum body.
Hey, hold on, Brian. Wait a minute. Hold on. That kid looks like he's got monster hands.
But no, it's because he's a responsible adult, Justin.
My God, wait, he's an adult?
Yeah, no, he's a well-respected, he's pretty much the authority on YouTube about lockpick reviews.
Oh my, wait, what? Brian, why did you offend him?
No, I didn't.
Why did you do that? He's an elder statesman in his craft. No. Why? Ryan, we need to apologize.
No, I didn't. So, okay. Look,
oh, my God. Oh, why did you lead me down this primrose path?
All right. So here, listen to him because I get real excited at the beginning because he says all these nice things.
Plus $10 shipping and handling. Unfortunately, there's a minimum order. I had to order two of these, but the shipping was $9.99.
Time out. That was my first moment that I was just like, press pause here. I was like, ooh, that's factually not true.
So what, you can only order one?
Oh, yeah, well, you can order as many as you want, including the number one.
I'll tell you what, prove Brian a liar. Buy one right now.
No, it's not an ad. This segment is not supposed to be an ad.
Hey,
listen, Brian, this isn't an ad. This isn't an ad, all right? And it's so much of an ad that I'm going to seal my mouth with a sticker that I got from stickersdiaf.com.
Wait, stickers are diaf.com?
Sticker merch.
Stickers are diaf.com. Is that a way to get Justin Robert Young-related stickers and support your independent podcasting efforts?
Absolutely, Brian. Go to stickersordiaf.com. We're almost sure to never offend an old man with a YouTube.
Okay, stop. I don't know how old he is. He seems like a nice grown-up.
Take two. My bad. Stickers are diaf. We're almost sure to not offend that guy who's offended by Brian.
All right. So listen to what he starts off saying here.
The shipping was $9.99.
Okay. All right. So he gets it wrong on the fact that he says there are two. That's fine. It's fine.
Pretty hefty pen, very large for a pen. And the selling point on this is that in the end of it, there's a piece of carbide. And in the video, they show a guy.
See,
and I'm
all super excited
a piece of
because,
glass
like, yes. That's exactly right. He accurately describes, you can keep it played here. He accurately describes, you know, how to, you know, it's emergency for cracking glass.
Not to do that unless you are wearing some Kevlar protective gloves and even some sleeves, because as soon as you punch through, that glass is really going to cause you some serious injury. So please, think about experimenting.
Glass
if you
is
end
not,
up with
you know, like
these.
A
so
car window.
Carbide tip in one end, right? And on the other end, they say they can use this to protect yourself.
Right. So,
and this is called crenellated. This is crenellation. These little spikes on the
end
of the idea behind having something crenellated is if someone is doing something you don't like, you can punch them with this. And the idea is that it'll punch.
Yep. And all of this still
deep enough and sharp enough.
Like right on. Like he's doing a good job. Like I would hire this guy to work my booth.
Oh my God, Brian, how could this go wrong?
Of the pen insert is actually pretty good. I did some writing with it, and it's very smooth. So they didn't cut any corners.
Hey, time out. Hey, Justin. What were the two things that you said the pen did?
Well, you know, here, Brian, it breaks the glass, and it's a pen.
It writes, and it writes very well.
You can write whatever you want. I'm going to tell you a few things that you can write with this pen. Just off the top of my dome, the Magna Carta. You can write it. Write the deed to a house. You can write. You can paint a pretty picture of the life that you left when you moved away from your hometown. Like anything that you want, you can write with this pen.
See, that's what I'm thinking, right? Okay, so at this point, we are now mathematically coming up on the halfway point. We're literally, it's been nothing but glowing praise for all this, and then we get to this point.
Screw off the crenellated part, and when you do, the spring-loaded pen cartridge pushes out this little carrier, and you can see inside of there a whole bunch of inserts for some picks.
See, pause it. This is great. So far, we're at creeping up on the 2/3 mark, and everything's been positive. And then keep going. Yeah, here we go. This is the part I don't know.
Let's take a look at this. We're going to put the cartridge down. Here are the picks that you get, and I have to say, I'm not going to waste a lot of time. These are the crappiest picks made out of the cheapest. Soft.
Okay, so this is the moment that halfway through the video I'm like, oh. and then I'm thinking, well, maybe he'll try it on a lock, or, you know, because I tried them and they worked fine on the, you know, on the 5-pin locks that we have. I mean, yes, I suppose if you're a full-time professional, you can probably get superior tools, but my guess is you probably don't buy a pen for the, high quality professional gear.
Something about
gear.
The best tools you can buy. Can they write a short story involving a tailless tabby? Because if they can, then I would like you to email me that story. JustinRobertYoung@gmail.com. Take a picture of the story you've written about a tailless tabby with your lock picks. And send it to mail@nightattack.tv. Handwritten stories only that you've written with lockpicks. And in that story, there must contain at least one tailless tabby.
So they're fine picks. And yes, if you're going to buy a set of lockpicks, we have better picks. You can get the jackknife, which is freaking amazing if you want a full, actual pro gear. But the point is not to have pro gear. The point is to have...
Safe to say, these are emergency picks.
Yes, that's
emergency
the point.
Emergency picks.
Okay, but, so if we're counting stars.
It'd be like looking at a donut that you get with your car, which is for an emergency, where if your tire is ripped apart, you can at least have a donut because it's better than nothing, and saying, I'm not going to put that on my F1 racer.
Well, okay, so here's the part.
That is a garbage.
Here's the funny part. We have not even gotten to the part that confuses me. Like, at this point, I'm like, oh, he said some nice things at the outset. This is the part where he's savage. He's a lockpick guy. Of course, he's going to, rail on the
car. He's harsh on you. You want to know what? He's tough, but he's fair.
That's what I was thinking.
Tough, but fair.
Right. But then, okay. So just scooch a boot like 30 seconds forward here,
and then
go back, and this is the point.
Not real well, as you can see, but that.
Okay,
so he
talks about things he wishes that the lockpicks did, which they're not designed to do, and that's all fine.
So then
after 25 seconds of shitting on the lockpicks, he then goes into complimenting it again.
Can never unless you're looking for. The crenellation part.
He goes into reasons why you should buy the pen.
An aluminum bodied pen with a piece of carbide stuck in the end, or if you really like how it looks and you want a pen, then maybe I can see spending your $30. But other than that, fellas, don't waste your money on this junk.
Okay, wait for it.
The thing that they send you, they don't tell you about, is this little LED light, and it does come with a battery. So, yeah, man, this is a cool little flashlight. The rest of this, not so much. Anyway, I'm going to give these away. I got two of them because two was the minimum order.
Not true! Not true! So anyway, and then he goes on. And then so basically, he says, he pulls a Homer Simpson. He goes, I'm going to give this pen my worst review ever. 9 thumbs up.
Brian, I feel like you confuse this man.
He confuses me. I don't understand what's happening.
I feel like you guys need to meet in a field. Field and just look at each other. No words exchanged. And just see into each other's souls while I whisper from the hilltop, understand.
Well, here's what I think we're going to do. The only thing that I'm really concerned about is that he had the impression that he had to buy 2, which is not true. So I think I'm going to have John reach out to him and say, like, hey, man, how did that happen? You want us to refund one or whatever? And then I guess the other thing is we'll just start sending him our new releases. And hopefully, I don't know, hopefully we'll find one he likes, because I know we got something he likes. I mean, he liked 8 of the 9 features of this one.
Well, I think things would have gone differently. Because this is an everyday use pen with emergency lockpicks.
Yes.
You should create a new product that is everyday use lockpicks that are emergency pens. And I feel like then you could send it to a pen report. Listen, I just broke into my neighbor's house and I rifled through all of his stuff and he never knew.
What we'll do is we'll send.
But look at oh my God, I'm trying to do my taxes with these and this is a real crap pen.
We'll send him a high quality set of lockpicks with just like duct tape, a pen, a big pen on there. It's the amazing writing proof lockpick sets.
Listen, you can always send John. John will be your emissary, right?
To be honest, I'm nothing but kind of jazzed that our horseshit operation has reached a level where grown-ups are actually looking at it and they're not grading on a curve. Like they're looking at it in a vacuum. They're like, I don't know who this guy is. I don't know what scam stuff is. I don't even know that that's related to scam school. What's a scam school? I'm just evaluating this. And again, I don't know. It's look, this is the grown-up. It's awesome. I'm becoming a grown-up, Justin. That's what's exciting. But not as exciting as having 1,638 patrons supporting our live independent horseshit podcast. How awesome is that?
Oh my God, that's the most awesome. Ladies and gentlemen, our summer of 1776 continues. You know, if anybody is listening and doesn't support, why don't you go ahead and kick in for any amount of money that you have, man. A nickel a tickle, a dime a lime, a quarter for blorders.
A dime a rhyme. Also, we'll only perform in couplets from now on.
Yeah, also a dollar make you holler, a Tubman for your love, man. Go ahead and kick it into the show.
Hold on, did you just say a Tubman for your love, man?
Yeah.
That's amazing. Okay.
Tubman's, she's going to be the new 20.
Yeah, I know. But you just caught
better
me.
Than Tub Girl. Hello, internet comedian here. My name's Justin Robert Young, making jokes here on the internet. All right.
Do you know what Tub Girl is?
God. Oh, no.
No?
I probably
do. You have a guess?
Know.
You have a guess?
I bet there is a girl that you can watch that does the tub challenge.
What's the tub challenge?
She sits down and can she eat the whole tub of ice cream? Yeah, she can.
That's exactly what it is, Bonnie.
It is?
No.
The hopeful
the more we build to the inevitable conclusion of us showing you Tub Girl.
Enjoy your ignorance while you still can, sweetheart.
No, this isn't happening, is it? I don't know. Brian has spared me a few greats, like he's never showed me Goatsy, although I think I have an idea. although I don't think he's the one that
invent. You don't think Brian's Goatsy? Because there's been a lot of people out there saying that Brian might be Goatsy, and I don't think so either.
I think it's a conspiracy.
Okay, hold on. I found a list of the best shock sites, but I can't. Oh, here we go. Jobgirl.ca is something nobody should look at. Oh, Christ. I forgot.
What? What? What did you do?
I'm going to try to hold this up just under.
I can't see that far.
Here.
Ooh. Why did you do that? It is. It's chocolate ice cream.
Yeah. Anyway, patreon.com/nightattack. It goes and funds this very show where we're on the roll to 1776 for the summer. We're going to be cool for the summer with you guys if you head on over to patreon.com/nightattack. Hey, Brian, you want to know what you get if you're a patron?
Besides that awesome video of the old lesbian and the 12-year-old?
Besides, that's for free, man. That's just to get them in the door. They're like, hey, who's that middle-aged rugby player and her young Brazilian ward?
No, dude, I'm going to bet that you get early access to tracks that are going to make up the next album. I bet that you're going to get mixtapes on the reg.
How about this one? Hey, y'all. We weren't live last week. We did a live show on Saturday. But guess what did drop on last Tuesday? How about a brand new mixtape, a.k.a. Fancy Feast? It is on that website right now, patreon.com/nightattack. If you can become a patron right now and just go back and listen to Fancy Feast. We got a little
can we get a little taste of that action there, Bryce?
Maybe if you stretch for a minute.
Yeah, that's fine. Oh yeah, long enough for him to log in.
Was up in Oakland. We were doing the show the next day. We recorded a bunch of tracks. I thought we got off to a really, really fast start. There was a lot of funny stuff in there, including the mixtape gets its name from a story that Brian tells that when this next album comes out. I don't care.
Oh, dude, it's definitely going to be a track. I can't believe it's such an awesome treat to be able to tell stories that you haven't heard yet. Let's listen to a random element of this week's mixtape. Available early to patreon.com/
That was an amazing performance. That was something that the likes of which I'm very impressed by.
Yeah, the cop's in the middle of taking your statement, and all of a sudden you just start slow clapping as the guy drives away.
And then the cop starts slow clapping, and then the guy that I hit starts slow clapping. And then eventually the guy's like, I've never had a reaction like this. Finally, I can ascend to my home planet.
P.S. He died on his way to the home planet. This is a good one. You definitely want to become a patron. When you become a patron, do you get access to all the previous mixtapes?
All of them.
Oh,
you
dude.
You get basically, think of the Patreon feed as just a password-protected blog, basically.
Oh, so, dude.
Like, as soon as you get access to it, you get all of it.
We actually got complaints. People are like, this is too good. Save it for the album. And you're like, yeah, there's no saving. It's like either we release it now or we forget that we have it on a hard drive somewhere.
Like, we need to get these things out because there was a point where we're like, oh, let's do mixtapes. Mixtapes will be really, really fun. We've recorded a bunch of stuff. Let's dig into these archives. And we're like, okay, we know that between times it's Brian's been to Oakland, I've been to Austin, we've got X amount of treasure trove of stuff, right? And I'm like, all right, Brian, where is it? Brian's like, man, talk to the wind. Talk to the sun god. Where do dreams go?
I just talk to Cthulhu, and I just talk to Cthulhu. The snake move.
Like, listen, at some point, we just go through, things happen, right? Brian switches computers. I move. We switch over stuff. Computers crash. It's like we just got it. We got to record it and get it out, right? Because that's what is best for the patrons. And ultimately, we're going to do a big album, but we'll record a bunch of original stuff for that, and that'll be probably right around the time that we publish the album.
I'm so stoked about it. I feel like we have momentum on our version of Chinese democracy. Like, I'm really stoked to come back and knock it hard. Not as stoked as I am, though, for our fantastic guest. Ladies and gentlemen, you've heard his work.
You've heard his review of Brian's lockpick. Just kidding, ladies and gentlemen. Uncharted 4 is currently the most talked about game in all of video games. And one of the men who brought it to your ear hole specifically is audio engineer by day, our BFF by night, ladies and gentlemen, Rob Krekel.
Huzzah!
Hey.
butt.
Rob, we always love having you on. Number one, because very rarely do we have, and we made a decision probably about a year ago to stop having strangers on the show because
we became shut-ins essentially.
Listen, I know. Oh wait, what's the pathway to success in podcasting? Interview famous people. Yeah, we're not good at that at all. Let's just keep having our friends on the show, which has very much been enjoyable for us and I believe the audience. You are a perfect example because you are somebody that not only is an amazing human being and doing awesome stuff, but also is very familiar with the program, and we're always so thrilled that you are. Welcome back.
Well, thank you. It's been a while, so I'm happy to be back.
By the way, I hope I'm not talking out of school here, but it's good to see you with joy in your heart and life in your eyes because you know, I don't know if you know this, video game industry has a little thing they call crunch, which is usually, you know, a few weeks right before release. It sounds as though Rob essentially lived at his desk and got a shore leave for 3 hours a week to go visit his family, essentially. But now you're on vacation, right?
Yeah. And the only reason I'm here is for this. So yeah. Thanks for that, I guess.
So is it a ghost town around the office?
No. People are in and out. You know, it's kind of round robin with taking vacations and whatnot. So there's people around.
Well, and you guys are always, listen, there's a reason why once a year you guys put out a game that completely lights the world on fire, because I'm sure you're working on the next, you know, the Last of Us Uncharted crossover that's going to, you know, melt everybody's faces.
A lot of stupid people that don't know when to go home. That's basically it.
I believe it.
So for those of you, it's been a while since we've had you on with the bit that we want to do now, which I'm now realizing we didn't explain to you at all.
We're doing. Oh, this is great.
This is something that we've done before. How would you explain to new listeners to the show what you do at Naughty Dog?
Oh, geez. Here we go. I'm a sound designer, and basically that means I make all the sounds in the game, or at least I contribute. It's a big team. But that often requires recording things or foleying things. I don't know if you guys heard the term foley before, but it basically means looking at what's in the game or in the movie and grabbing props and making sounds. And I think I know where this bit is going.
So, for example, like if you were on, I remember whenever you would go to Universal Studios in Orlando, they would have this like movie magic behind the scenes kind of tour. And they would show you that, you know, what might sound like somebody punching somebody in the ribs and breaking their ribs is really just a bag of potato chips or something like that. That audio is something that you can manipulate to sound a certain way with many things that are found around your average household.
Yeah. That's exactly what it is.
So what we like to do is completely abuse your world-class training and skills to come up with bizarre and ridiculous sounds that are suggested by the chat realm so we can do a little live foleying here on the show and create absolute unique sounds that the world can then go forth and use.
Sounds like a plan.
Hold on. Time out. I want... All right, so Bonnie also did not know what we're going to do, right?
Yeah.
She hears the bit, looks over at me with eyes bigger than pie plates, and then said, you know, mouthing the words, oh. And then I'm like, and you know, you're talking, so I'm looking, I'm like, yeah. And then I see, like, talk words, and I don't know what she's mouthing, but it's, I assume it's like, oh, you guys should do a whatever, and I'm like, oh, we should do a what, and then she appears to hold a banana
and
banana with a grapefruit on it and go and proceeds to
oh, well, you know, I'll tell you what. We could definitely, that could be something that we could work up to.
Okay. Can we warm up? Actually, can we warm up by
as much as video games and movies do?
Can we warm up by listening to just that sound, just isolated, audio. Just the audio of that sound, and ask Rob how he would create it?
Well, no. Here's what I would like. Rob, listen. You are somebody that has to create sounds and fit them into the world of the games that you create. Now, you don't have to use an example from games that you work on, which are obviously very important franchises. But if you were to just close your eyes and listen to this sound, how would you fit it in to a video game or movie franchise?
There you go.
All right.
Here we go.
All right. Good. So here we go. This is the sound that we are going to play for you.
All right.
All right. You know, now, Rob, you can put it into any video game. Man. What is it?
That's, you know, Drake getting dragged behind the trucks like that. You'd mix that in there.
Oh, hold on. Let me try that on for size. Let me hear it again. Picturing Drake.
I swear to God, somebody find a goddamn, somebody find a video of Drake getting dragged behind a truck right
There's
now.
There's plenty up there. Go find one.
Maybe through a swamp, through the mud, or?
Through the mud, man. Yeah, you're getting dragged through the mud.
So
that mud, mud tech, yeah.
Can you please do that in the next one? Can you steal that?
Send me the file.
Oh, no. You're going to have to bring her in. What's her name again? What's
Angel. Angel.
You're going to have to say, hey, listen, Angel, we need you in L.A. immediately. Drake's got to get dragged through the mud.
Speak into my microphone, please.
There you go. I brought a grapefruit. I brought...
All right. Well, here we go. I saw one suggestion. Put your suggestions in the chat room. We will create the wilder that.
Oh, jeez. Hold on. We actually have. That was amazing. All right. So we've got the visual now of Drake being dragged in the mud. Let's just imagine
let's
if we
put the two together. Here we go.
So what you're going to do is just suck his dick. That's like you said.
Here we go. It's pretty good. It's
almost like I'm there. I tell you what, these video games get more realistic every year.
That was amazing. All right, chat realm, let's open it up to you guys. What sound effect would you like to see recreated by the amazing Foley talents?
Somebody, T2T2, I believe, wrote the sound of Brian turning into a puddle of self-regret.
Oh, yeah, what would that sound like?
And the way we like to... you are our audio director, Rob, so I can go scrambling around my house and get whatever we need to create this audio sound. I will go collect the materials that you suggest.
I don't think this is a single sound. I think this is more of a sound story. So it's going to kind of evolve over time.
Okay. All right. So what do we need?
A towel.
Okay.
And some baby oil, maybe, or cooking oil of some kind. Some kind of
gotcha.
Oil.
All right. Yep.
And maybe like a leather jacket or a vinyl jacket, something like that.
Are we looking for the material or the zipper?
Extremely embarrassing moment for Mr. Brushwood.
Oh, jeez.
Okay. All right. So I'm going to go get it. Towel, do you mean cloth towel or paper towel?
Cloth towel, like a bath towel.
All right. BRB.
Oh, damn it. Okay. Look, in the meantime, if I may inject into the creative process here, I don't mean to tell you your motivation or direction or whatever, but it's like Brian descending into a puddle of regret is... It's not like, you know, the Eiffel Tower suddenly turning to jello. It's more like a wet noodle finally giving up and just falling down on your desk.
It's
maybe.
Not at all like that, Brian.
All right, so we got to come up with a narrative. We have to have a moment where this makes sense. Like, name one time ever that Brian has melted into a puddle of self-regret, Bonnie.
Ooh, you're putting me on the spot. Self-regret?
Yeah, see? You can't name one.
I can't name
I've
one.
I've never had regret about anything.
Pretty sure there's one recorded on an album, maybe.
Oh, jeez. Oh, yeah, which the regret, sure, that I didn't take the HJ from that Jakartan princess.
Oh, gosh. Princess.
I'm glad,
really?
You knew where this is going.
I'm trying to be nice.
Princesses can be old too.
What? What? She was, okay, she was more of a.
She was not.
She was a mid-50s housewife, whatever. Hey, Justin's back.
Look at that.
Oh, my God.
That is some artisan-ass looking oil.
Yeah, that's pretty nice, Justin.
Oh, no, it's Whole Foods. Stop it. That's a bitch.
Yeah, sell out.
all right, so, wait. Do we need water?
Maybe to clean yourself up.
after you come, after you experience
this holy work. Oh, I rolled dirty AF. Let's just get into it.
Wait, we got oil, a towel, and a leather jacket. Yeah. Where is this going?
All right. Walk us through this.
All right, so some of you might be familiar with a certain story about a special massage.
Yeah.
And we're going to recreate some of the sounds that were involved in this.
All right, good.
Starting with the removal of a piece of clothing. So, Justin, if you would.
Can we real quick? All right, let's go in order. Bonnie, would you mind playing the role of my masseuse in Jakarta, Indonesia, after I appeared on international television for 7 million people?
Please do not land us on motherjones.com tomorrow. Do not do the accent.
What is Mother Jones? I'm not doing it.
Oh, yeah, no accents.
Okay. I was like, I'm not doing an accent. Unless I can do a Texas accent.
Yes. Okay.
Sure.
Oh, no. Bonnie. Yeah. What a crazy situation. Brian escapes across the world and is offered a hand job by a woman with a Texas accent. Oh, the exotic nature of this offer will never be understood.
All right. Well, hello. I'm here for my massage. I guess, should I get undressed?
Hi, handsome. Yeah, you just go make yourself comfortable right over there.
Okay, allow me to take off my clothes.
Yeah.
Justin?
Right over there.
Wait, don't talk over the Foley, Bonnie.
Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, all right. I'm sorry.
I'm going to take off my clothes. All right.
Oh my goodness! I kept on my.
I'm clearly uncomfortable with this whole scene, which was why I took off my clothes so quickly. I'm still wearing my skivvies though, because it would be awkward otherwise. Because this is somehow less awkward. So I'm gonna lay down. I guess lay down on this this here table.
Yeah, sugar.
All right, and then here I am. I'm going to be face down because I'm extremely awkward in situations like this, and I'm terrified of getting inappropriate boners.
All right, here, Rob. I'm gonna need some direction here.
So
I need some direction where we're going.
Will be the crinkle of him laying down on the massage table.
Yeah.
So
let me get. I'm just gonna lean over. I'm gonna get on this massage table.
So just
a little squeeze of something. Just a.
Crank your volume. Crank your volume, Justin. Give it that leather twist.
And then a thump. Like a nice thump.
A thump of me laying down on it.
Perfect.
Oh.
Yeah, now it's an ASMR video.
What's made you so tense?
I did a TV thing, and there's this one woman. She kept looking at me with her fingers were like a cloud beneath her chin, kind of resting. She looked intently. And then we talked about it on, at a Kinko's down the street.
All right. Is there massage sounds?
So now
because I'm massaging
we're
talking.
That's what the oil's for, Justin, if you can get a little bit on your hands, enough to coat them with a thick, full coat.
Please stop talking, miss. I like my massages silent. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'm going to enjoy this. Here I am. Enjoying.
You can't.
So, wait, are you telling me you can actually hear the sound of oil on a hand?
Like this, Justin. Yeah, there you go.
I'm sorry.
Oh, ma'am, are you a bit excited to be rubbing an international celebrity?
Oh, I've never done this before. Only every week.
All right, so now Justin, he's going to flip over.
Oh, hang on, let me flip over. Oh, dear.
Oh!
I I'm going to pretend you're not there, ma'am. I'm just going to do my best to think of dead puppies. Let's remember every graphics card I've ever purchased. There is the NVIDIA TNT, the NVIDIA TNT 2, 3D effects, the Voodoo 1, Voodoo 2.
Do you just want a hand job?
Is that what you said? I don't know.
Yeah, come on. I mean, that's subtext. I mean, so, okay, dance around. She danced around it. She danced
it's
around
radio,
it.
It's radio. I mean,
all right. Okay. You know, like I'm trying real hard not to think about the fact that somebody's invasively rubbing my inner thighs
I'm
right now.
I'm rubbing your thigh. It's fine. Look at that thigh, honey. Your thigh sure is rock hard. Needs a lot of rubbing.
I'm sorry. I'm not interested.
All right, here, Rob.
Oh God.
Sorry, but hey, you're still real hot on the mic. There you go.
Rob, where are we going? Where are we going?
It's like, you know what? Can we just end this with the fantasy that she just gives me the jerk off?
No, we're not doing audio porn, bro.
No, and then I think Brian starts crying.
Yes!
The shame has welled up.
Okay, is there a way that we can enhance that audio wise?
Yeah, can you give us? I'll tell you what. You be my stunt crier, Justin. But adjust your volume down because you're pretty blown out right now.
Okay, is this good?
Sure. Better? All right, here we go. We'll get you goosed up. All right, there we go. So ask me again, Bonnie, and I'll say no, and then Justin will provide our out.
Do you want me to massage above your thigh a little more?
No! This is really awkward. I'm married. I'm pointing to my wedding ring. It's not gonna. I kind of wanted to see how long you were going to go. I'm the spookiest, most haunted puddle of defeat that ever tried to get or that was ever offered a hand job in Indonesia.
Why am I so not threatened by any of this?
Now we've also knocked out the sound effect for epileptic puppy with birth defects. So. Can always get a lot of uses out of these.
Somebody
was
suggesting.
The beauty of sounds is they're multi-use. Once you have them forever, and you can.
Oh,
just
sure,
using.
Absolutely.
Somebody was suggesting that maybe we could. Oh, doggone it! Never mind. Somebody, I was going to open the Theremin app and give it a little bit of that ghost job.
Well, here we go. I feel like there's just one thing that we need to make sure that we get because. The last time that we had you on, we set the bar very, very high because somebody came up with the idea to create the sound effects for what was eventually called a Terry pile. Now, you might ask yourself, for new listeners and viewers, what's a Terry pile? Well, I'll tell you. It's when Mother Teresa takes a poop. Or at least it was. Rest in peace.
I mean, maybe she's been holding it in, and it's only after half a decade of rest that she can finally let go.
Oh my God, wait, hold on. Whiskey Wolf in the chat room says that he has put together the grapefruit sound with Drake being dragged through the mud.
No way. Wait, this is
just the official trailer.
Yeah, this is just the official
trailer. You gotta put it next to the thing.
Oh, well, no.
You can't just send us a clip and tell us you made something. No. Yeah, no.
Oh, no.
Shame.
Oh, I say no too.
Sorry, go ahead.
So here's what we need. We need some kind. I think we've all proven that we're very capable on the fly improv audio engineers and can tell a full story with enhancement sound effects. But oh, wait, here. Carl has the Terry pile.
Oh, dude. This is the moment.
Sorry. I appear to have me the polio.
Ha ha ha!
Oh, that's all right. Go and sit on the table.
It's amazing.
Oh, by the way, I didn't mean to misrepresent you, Whiskey Wolf. I was just reading on the fly. So here's what we need. We need to have something like that, just a moment in history, something that is outlandish that you would that the world has not given us access to.
Yeah,
no one's ever heard.
Give it to us, chat realm. What's the moment that you've always wanted to experience on an audio journey that up until now has never been possible?
So we just need, it doesn't have to be a whole story, just one sound. The one sound the world has never heard, we will recreate with the help of a world-class audio engineer right here, live for you.
Donald Trump, running of the bulls, acid trip, splorp, alley soup, Trump taking a dump, 1969 moon landing, old man chasing those damn kids, the sounds of my mother loving me, rainbow
sounds
fart.
That no one's ever heard.
Queen Elizabeth queefing. John Stossel stomach growling. Jeff roommate select closing.
What my actual dad sounds like.
Ted Cruz killing a victim. Yeah, man. Take your pick. What do you like here, Rob?
The Queen Elizabeth queef that was highlighted might be.
Yeah?
Might be fun.
Okay, so let's talk about queefs. Bonnie.
Let's talk about queefs, baby.
Bonnie, I want you to explain to me. Let's talk about queefs, Bonnie. Let's talk about them to me. About all the air that comes out of your vagina when you lean. Let's talk about
queefs.
Do I get to divorce him now? No. Is this it? Do you guys all, you all were witness.
All right, so the sound could be Bonnie queefing while divorcing Brian.
No, or I think it should be Queen Elizabeth, because think about it. It's an old cooter, like dusty. Like, you want...
You guys are misogynist.
I'm sorry, it's an old lily, decayed and desiccated, with its flowery and precious fragrant scent.
I mean, Bonnie, it's just science, like... You know, you get older, it's just science.
So, okay, now, by the way, like, farts and queefs are, like, fundamental. Time out, because I just want, you know, this is all. Oh. I just got to look for body I've never seen before. In fact, picture, I'm sorry, sweetheart, picture an angry walrus who flops his flippers back in indignation. His eyes bug out and he leans forward like, do you really want to take this fish from me?
Now you're working fish into the story. You're a real asshole tonight.
Yeah, you know you're.
And Brian, you haven't been this offensive since that lockpick review.
You're killing me. I mean, but like quit, like farts are start in your guts and they make your way down to your butt. But queefs are just like inhaling. They're the exhale part of an inhale. Is that what's going on?
Out. Breathe in, breathe out. Bush fans? Anyway, go ahead.
It's about queefs. Breathe in. Okay, Bonnie's not willing to confirm or deny any of this. This is why it's a mystery.
Secrets. State secrets.
Yeah, I'm not going to rat us ladies out.
Rat ladies?
Yeah. Oh, hey, why don't you just call your lovely wife and... Justin, ask her about it.
Yeah, because he's smarter than I
summoning?
Am.
Are we summoning Ashley? We could summon Ashley. Hold on.
Let's get Barrister Paramore in here.
Mr. Young, I do believe you're speaking about my queefs on the live stream again.
Hold on. Wait a minute. We're gonna get her in here, hopefully. Yep, here she goes. Ladies and gentlemen, Ashley Paramore. Grab the mic there. Let's turn you up.
Why?
All right, go.
Why,
talk.
Why are you yelling about my vag?
Well, I mean, it's not only your vag. It's really the world's vag. We have Rob. Well,
are you
here.
Saying I'm a hussy? What is? mean, not...
Here's what I'm saying. Okay. We have world class audio engineer Rob Krekel on the show.
I've heard of him.
And well, as we've done before, we are recreating a sound very rarely heard. Last time it was Mother Teresa taking a poop. This time it's going to be the Queen of England queefing. Brian, you had questions.
Yeah, no, it's like, okay, first of all, like, everyone's always like, girls never fart. And in high school, I was like, well, mathematically, they have twice as many ways. So clearly, they must fart at some point. But then it got me thinking, like, farts start from food you ate in your belly, and then they come out your butt. But, like, queefs are, that's just like, that's like the exhale part of an unfortunate inhale at some point. Is that a thing?
I just need Brian. I just need that clip to be with Brian with a brick wall in the back and just like have it, an 80s mic in his hand as he does that. Actually, true or false, where do queefs come from?
Did you say true or false? Where do queefs come
incorrect.
From?
Incorrect. It was a true or false question.
Just say true. Get it over with.
Brian wants to know. So queefs are air trapped in the vagina and then expelled.
Yes.
True.
True.
Right? Okay. Any further questions?
Yes, and this is to all the ladies on our panel.
The forced air.
Forced air.
So do you feel the air go in at some point, and then you're like, oh, I have one loaded in it.
Do you feel it calling in the air tonight?
Oh, it's just like, hello.
It just sort of slides in, and you're like, hey, I'm back.
Yeah.
And you're like, all right.
Hello, it's me.
I feel like that's about as far as we can go with anyone we actually know. We can only speak in the theoretical.
Orison says in the chat room, do not blow into the vagina to create a queef. That's how you would give a woman an embolism. Science facts here on the show, everybody. You know, you can learn about the body by listening to this show. Please support us on public radio. Dial NPR into your phone and hang up.
Night Attack, the number one science podcast on iTunes.
Yeah. So here's... I guess, do we have any other questions about queefing?
No, that's all I got. Well, yes. Okay.
All right.
How would a dusty, nearly 100-year-old vagina sound different queefing than a tight, slippery, wet...
Are you calling me old then?
No. I'm just asking.
The Queen of England.
Like,
no,
okay.
No, you're the tight, slippery vagina.
Like,
that
okay,
Brian
so
was
here's
describing.
What I'm thinking. I'm no expert in Foley like Rob Krekel, but I'm thinking like if I want to do a 23-year-old queefing, I would grab two strips of bologna and then blow between them, right? But if I was gonna do like an old,
it's not a trombone, like one of those tuning things that barbershop quartets play before they start singing.
Well, but so, meanwhile, if I was gonna do like a 100-year-old woman, I'd grab two flour tortillas and then go between. Am I wrong? Right, okay, I'm just gonna...
This
I'm just gonna,
is very wrong.
Everything about this is wrong, I'm sorry.
Oh, crap, I think I...
Because, like, they're dusty, they got the flour dust on them, no?
I mean, all right, we can call...
What does the sound of the old church door
We can
like
call an older woman.
You would not... I'll divorce you too. your mom's amazing, by the way.
Am I calling my mom? I gotta call my mom.
Oh, God. You ever have one of those moments where you see something happen and you can't do anything about it?
You can't stop it, sorry. Are we on speaker?
Yeah, you are. We're on speaker right now.
Here we go.
Hey, Mom.
Hello.
How are you doing?
Good, honey. What's up?
Did you have a good Mother's Day?
I did.
How is baby Jackson?
Baby Jackson still just a cute little bundle of baby.
All right. So, hey, real quick, you're live on the internet. We want to ask about queefing.
Oh, boy.
As you've gotten older, how would you say the difference in your queefs have been?
Difference in my what?
Are you familiar with the term queefing?
No.
Oh, man. All right.
You have to educate me.
I mean, it would be like an exhalation of air from your vagina.
Oh, my goodness. Okay, and so now how is that supposed to mix with sleeping?
Okay, so number one, no, not sleeping. No, the term for it is called queefing. Q-U-E-E-F.
Oh,
right?
Got it.
Wait, did they call it got something it. Different when you were growing up?
No, I don't think I've ever heard a term for that.
It wasn't like Eisenhower's toot? All right.
Nope, never heard of it.
So, okay, but you're familiar with the physical thing.
Yes.
Okay. So we have a world-class audio engineer, and we're trying to recreate a sound. Did a sound of a queef sound differently when you were younger compared to now?
I don't think it would sound any different. No.
All right. Well, then listen. We came for a scientific explanation. Thank you very much, Mom. I love you.
Happy Mother's Day.
Love you too.
Love you too. Bye-bye. Happy Mother's Day.
Your mom's a national treasure, Justin.
I'm amazed at how well she handled that.
Here's by the way, there's a moment. Because I'm just going to let everybody know, especially for those of you who only listen via audio, this chat room is a viper's nest.
Oh, Jesus. Yeah.
This chat room is merciless, right? And there is a moment when everyone in the chat room is almost universally screaming, no, 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 hang up, abort, too real, too gross, that I feel like Daenerys burning the Khalasar. Like I just step out triumphant and say, yes, none of you are gross enough to ask your mom live on the internet about how her queeps have sounded through the years.
Okay, so we got it from an authority that there is no difference. Apparently, the bologna versus flour tortilla method is wrong. So I think we've given you everything.
Hey, listen, man, you know, flames can melt steel beams. So, you know, listen, we're all learning a lot today.
Okay, so I've already got the scene all figured out. It's Queen Elizabeth's first ever visit to Texas. And she's leaning over to pick up some Tex-Mex. I burped. Sorry. Some Tex-Mex. And then she accidentally queefs, and she happens to be leaning right over a microphone when it happens. It creates an international incident. What is that sound?
Yeah. Robbie, you got to give me some materials to work with.
Dude, this is like, for this is one of the simplest, greatest sounds. These kind of sounds, because they're easy to make.
Oh.
And they don't require many tools. Really, your arm will do.
Oh.
All right.
But the hard part here is not the sound itself, it's the performance.
Okay.
And so it needs to sort of start low and pitch up.
Rob, I'm going to need you to rope you in. I need you to introduce me to the folks here in Austin, Texas. I'm the Queen of England. Very excited.
Hey, guys, give me a wide berth so we can totally get out of the Skype well here, all right?
Yeah,
so,
you got it. Well, because it'll be a pregnant moment, so to speak.
Exactly, until that thing is totally done.
Before
anybody else jumps in.
Okay. Oh, yes, I'm very excited to be here from England. It sounded an awful lot like... Mother Teresa, young man, would you like to introduce me to the audience?
Hello, everyone, at this Tex-Mex restaurant. This is the Queen of England. Let's give her a nice Texas welcome.
Hello! Oh, Texas, I'm so very excited to be here. Let me, Tex-Mex, a little bit of salsa. I hear amazing things. Let me just bend over, dip my chip in there, and then I'll grab a little board. Oh dear, thank goodness nobody heard that. I'm the Queen of England. Good night. The Queef of England.
It was the undercarriage rumbling heard round the world as the Queen leaned over for Tex-Mex and the Queef was let loose. This is Justin Robert Young, BBC News.
Hot diggity dog, man. Hey, man, real quick, talking about sounds, we got only one sound that I hear about, and that's like very rarely does something Night Attack related cause my wife to become so sexually aroused that she takes to Twitter to talk about it. This is one of those things.
Yeah. Is it The Air Up There starring Kevin Bacon, which is apparently also about queefing?
No. This is definitely... Here, do me a favor. Just go to Penny's... Or to Penny's. To Bonnie's tweet.
Jesus Christ.
Sorry. Just do Control F and type in sploosh. I think that'll take you straight to it. Because, let's see. S-P-L-O-O... I mean, surely you got the S-P-L in there. Did you remove it? You removed it.
No.
I don't see it.
No. No. Maybe. Apparently it's not there. You're ashamed of yourself.
I might have been.
No. Your friend of mine, Stephen Cogswell, took our opening from the live show and made some delightful, enchanting art out of it, which we're going to hear momentarily. Dude,
this takes audio from our live show in San Francisco. Again, you know, one more time, I don't feel like we gave enough credit to everybody who came out here. We had people flying from across the country to do that show. You know, I guess here one sentence, going forward, safe to say we'll do more of these going forward, Brian.
Oh my God. Yeah. No, as a matter of fact, we're already picking the next, spot for that. It's going to be great. It was like a family reunion. It gave a different energy to the show. It presents to us the interesting puzzle of how to make a live show that, you know, because we're all inside baseball here, right? It's like we are unforgiving in our difficulty to penetrate the inside humor that we're doing. We're like, you know, hey, man, if you have any, all we ask is that you go back through the whole archive and watch 8 years of us farting around on the internet. That way you'll catch our jokes. Bye, jerks. Whereas like the live show, I really like the fact that there were people who had never heard of us and showed up and fell in love with the start of Spelling Bee.
Yeah, no, it was super exciting. And it was one of those things that I very much felt like it was the final piece of our puzzle. Cause we'd always kind of joked around that we were such a specialty act on the internet that we were kind of like the string cheese incident.
Yeah.
What they are to music. And gosh darn it, if we didn't go and play a live show and we had people come from around the country, and I'll tell you what, if we would have said, hey, guess what? The next show's in Sacramento. I bet you we would have had half the audience come out to that one too. So
exactly.
It really meant a whole lot. But from that show, the great and wonderful Stephen Cogswell made the following song.
We need a techno beat. Everybody clap to the same rhythm. Decide among yourselves what that is.
Oh my God, it came together.
Too fast. Too fast. Too fast. Slow down.
Down.
Too
down,
slow.
Down,
too slow.
Down, all right. Fast. Fast. Fast.
Soul clap.
All right. Ray and remember that time that we melted their face?
I know. Fuck it. It was a terrible bit.
Start the music. Remember that time that we melted your faces.
What?
Couldn't run Congress. Think again.
Their approval ratings are down, but the hijinks are up.
Remember that time that we melted your faces?
What?
Remember that time that we melted your faces?
Yeah.
We shouldn't feel good about melting your faces.
Too bad.
We shouldn't feel good about melting your faces. Remember that time that we melted your faces?
What?
Remember that time that we melted your faces?
Yeah.
We shouldn't feel good about melting your faces.
Too bad.
We shouldn't feel good about melting your faces.
Holy cow, man. Stephen Cogswell, awtfy.com/scarred. Why is he not taking our money? Why does he not have a Patreon? By the way, I realized like yesterday morning, I'm like, oh shit, like a third of the album is going to be, we have to ask Stephen super nice if we can, you know, use his music for half of our album.
Listen, in the dude is so talented, and he's only growing more talented. In fact, we should look into, a lot of people think we should look into a federal program to make sure he doesn't become more talented. After all, who would want these kinds of songs?
By the way, we did find Bonnie's tweet. It was an at reply to us where she said, something must be melting because there's total sploosh. Badass song.
The funny thing with Bonnie is that Bonnie, of course, is that perfect, beautiful, impossible mix of like art rock hero and like mother of three. So you don't know whether or not, yeah, sploosh is like, yeah, sploosh, right? Like, or like, yeah, sploosh, like if you're on a water slide. It could go either way. And that is the beautiful dichotomy for which Bonnie exists.
It's slippery either way. So.
It's what either way?
It's slippery either way.
Yes. It is a slippery slope.
Racist. All right. We've got, of course, Diamond Time. Diamond Time is where you can shout out your projects right here on the show. That is diamondclub.reddit.com or reddit.com/r/diamondclub. Right up there, sticking to the top, you will find a weekly spot where you can plug what you want to plug. Let's begin with Comrade Kale. He writes, hey, Chat Realmers, my tote sweet D&D group has been recording and making our sessions into a podcast. As to how I'm related to the project, I'm the funniest one. New episodes come out every Monday morning, and we are trying to fill the void that was left in our lives when Nerd Poker stopped. Check us out as a great way to get through the morning commute, trudge through work while you're on the way home to drink yourself to sleep, or just enjoy some good old-fashioned YOLO 420 swag adventures. Botched, a D&D podcast. You can find it at botchedpodcast.com.
Yeah, man, you want to listen to a random snippet, little snipple, grab the snip-nip, trip the nip on the slip.
I just want to do damage to it without, like, hitting him, so I just want to, like, try to, like...
Do subtle damage. Just...
Oh, this is good. So this is like fly on the wall, like you're there.
That's just punching me until I pass out.
Is he standing like this?
He's standing with his like hands and legs like in, like he's being wrapped up by like rope, that type of thing.
Go around the neck.
I'm gonna try it.
All right, that is
this is exactly, this is long form rad D&D stuff. I'm super excited that it was submitted. Check it out, Botched Podcast. He's got a bicycle. Ryan, you want to read the next one?
Heck yeah. Tinvec writes, do you play Hearthstone? Want to play in a Chat Realm tournament? Then you should play in the Game On Asshole Tournament 2016. Still lots of time to sign up. First day of play will be Saturday, June 4th. Details are at yolo420.com/goat2016. That's GOAT2016. The password is too soon, all one word. Questions, hit them up on Twitter. That's at Tinvec, T-I-N-N-V-E-C, or in the Chat Realm Discord. Yeah, I don't know what that any of this. And then he edited his thing. Yeah, man, dude, I've never been in a tournament of Hearthstone. Have you? Oh, yeah. Time that right the moment that you're about to pretend to suck a dog's dick.
I have, Brian. In fact, I have been in... I've been in two... three Hearthstone tournaments, the Angry Chicken tournament, where I am a routine fixture to get bounced in the first round.
Yeah, I believe it. That's hard. Hearthstone's hard.
Dude, all right. True story about this last Angry Chicken tournament.
Welcome
number
to the
one,
Angry
I
Jury
forgot
podcast.
That it was that day. Number two, your pal and mine, Darren Kitchen, and I wound up just getting like kind of faced the night before. I wake up and I'm like, goddamn, Angry Chicken tournament. I had to lie to the person that I was playing against because I didn't have, and this is super nerdy, so I'll keep it very, very.
No. I think I'm picking up what you're putting down. You lied when you said well played. You said it sarcastically when you selected that emote. You said
I didn't have enough decks. I should have forfeited the game as we started because I didn't have a warrior deck that was in standard mode. So I had to blame mobile connectivity because he's like, why'd you go to the main menu and then come back? And I was literally going to the main menu to just hit standardize on a deck, a warrior deck, to then play him with. It went to a game five with that warrior deck, and I lost.
Oh, that would have been amazing if you won.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, it would have been terrible, and I'm terrible, and I'm bad, and I should have lost. But I'm going to enter into this one, and I'm going to kick everybody's monkey ass.
All right. Next
and
up.
Fluffy Frog, who writes, top of the evening to yous. I don't know if you know, but we here in Alberta, Calgary, Alberta, Canada,
who still worship the queen as a living god, whether she queefs or not.
All right. Have been dealing with a huge amount of out-of-control wildfire. As I'm writing this,
hilarious,
it is an estimated 241,457 hectares, or the equivalent square miles for you Americans. The wildfire triggered the mandatory evacuation of five communities, the biggest one being in Fort McMurray, which is about 80,000 residents. Most evacuees were directed south down to Edmonton and Calgary, with some directed north, and others were directed east to Saskatchewan. So basically, I'm asking for help. I've compiled a list of charities that are looking for money. Go to YOLO420.com. Brian, you want to read the rest of this link?
Yeah. YOLO420.com. Fire evacuee help. That's F-I-R-E-S. I'm sorry. Fires evacuee. Okay, God.
Or you can actually read the one right below.
Oh, yeah. YOLO420.com/fuckfire.
Dude, this has been a very legitimate tragedy throughout Canada. And Brian will be donating to this charity.
Ah, son of a biscuit. Oh, I mean, I don't even know why I'm acting indignant or like, oh, golly, you got me again, young. I guess I'll have to give 10 whole dollars to someone whose life was turned upside down.
This is a major, 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 major tragedy. And if we have any Diamond Club folks that are affected by it, then certainly our hearts go out to you and we hope you reach out to us.
Let's take 4 seconds to think about literally anything other than a tragedy.
Hold on, wait a minute.
It's it's time for the Movie Draft Minute!
Welcome to your Movie Draft Minute presented by CosmicRadio.tv for the week of May 16th, 2016. I'm your host, Roberto Villegas. With a brand new movie out, someone has finally entered the board. Who is it? Let's go find out. Team Cord Killers is in sixth place. Still waiting for their first film. Team We Have Concerns is in fifth place with Money Monster bringing in $14.7 million this week. Team Antwerp is in fourth place with $58.9 million. Team Chainsaw Suit drops to third place with $356.9 million. Team Nitech is in second place with $366.3 million. And in first place with a whopping $374.3 million. It's Team DTNS. And that is your Movie Draft Minute for the week of May 16th, 2016.
Hot diggity dog. Justin, I don't think we...
Oh, good God. Jesus, Auntie Angel.
Sorry.
Getting dragged through mud?
Sorry. No, I think we're in trouble. I think we're in trouble on the movie draft. A demon just came in to tell me that. Yeah, I don't know that Civil War made enough money fast enough. DTNS, look at it this way. We have whatever money is left on Captain America Civil War, plus we have Secret Life of Pets and Ghostbusters up against DTNS's. They have Free State of Jones, Now You See Me 2, Star Trek Beyond, and Suicide Squad. Like, do you think?
Well, it really kind of depends on the quality of those movies. So, if Ghostbusters is good, Ghostbusters can make a lot of money. If The Secret Life of Pets is Kung Fu Panda, right, then we can, or, you know, we can do very, very well. But I think that we are betting on not only legs from Civil War, but both of those movies need to do above what they are tracking for us to win.
Yes, not looking real good.
Here's the problem, right? Is like, and I don't want to get into spoilers on Civil War, but you don't leave that movie pumping your fist and being really excited.
Well,
right?
And that's the problem. Like, the best set piece of Civil War, spoiler alert, there's a civil war between your favorite Marvel superheroes. Like, and then they start fighting each other and you think, who am I rooting for? It's like
if the movie ended there, if it ends at that airport and it just ends with Iron Man and Captain America smiling at each other and saying, ha, 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 I guess that got out of control. Freeze frame. Da, na, 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 na. I think everybody leaves that theater being like, oh my God, remember all that fun stuff that just happened? Unfortunately, between that scene, and by the way, it's why I love the movie and why it's my favorite Marvel movie is what happens after that scene. But it's some like really, really heavy stuff. Like it's depressing.
it was almost like a Rick and Morty moment where it's just like heavy, like it's like Roy the Video Game dark stuff happening. You're like, oh damn.
I mean, listen, I'm not going to say who. I'm just going to say that there's a moment where somebody sticks a revolver in their mouth and you don't know whether or not you want them to kill themselves. There's a real legitimate moral ambiguity on whether or not you want somebody to blow their brains out. Like, that's insane for a comic book movie, but you don't leave high-fiving each other and saying like, oh man, look at the fragility of life.
Did we already talk about how I was thinking halfway through that this movie, there's a moment they make a reference to The Empire Strikes Back, and I realize like that's not just a reference for that moment. That's them like really pushing the fact that this is The Empire Strikes Back of the Captain America franchise, because you have the origin story, right, and you have Winter Soldier, sort of the New Hope, but this one begins with a set piece that could be a standalone episode or a standalone movie, just like Hoth, that ends in a Pyrrhic victory on Hoth. It was the fact that they escaped, but they were defeated. And in this case, it's, you know, something, I don't know why. Spoilers are happening now. It's been long enough. It ends with the civilian casualties. During the second act, the gang all splits up to pursue different things. During the third act,
Somebody gets their arm chopped off. Somebody finds out who killed his dad. Somebody loses his lightsaber. Oh, wait, I mean his shield. It ends with a case where all the current fires are put out, but the larger questions are unresolved. Like, structurally, it's identical to The Empire Strikes Back.
I mean, if you want to write a cracked article, I'd read it and I'd like it. Right?
God damn
like,
it. All right. Yeah. Yeah.
I had not thought of it like that. This is the first time that I've ever thought of it like that. And from what you have said right now, yes, that makes sense. But leaving the theater, I didn't take that line as them saying, like, look at us, we're doing Empire Strikes Back. Although, I will say this, it's probably because that's such a worn-out trope of people talking about movies that, although listening to what you're saying, I probably agree with you more about it about this movie. I just am so burnt out on, like, whenever any sequel comes out, it's like, oh, well, this is their Empire Strikes Back. This is their Empire Strikes Back, because it and Godfather 2 are like the two movies that are like, here's how you do a sequel. Like, there's never been sequels like these movies that totally changed the game. And listen, I think that tonally, this is way different. This is so much darker than Winter Soldier, right?
Which already I thought was way darker than the first Avenger.
Well, yeah, and the first Avenger was like, it was a Joe Johnston movie. Like, it was this fun, big, shiny, it was like Rocketeer-esque, like, you know, let's punch those Nazis in the jaw, pow! And this is, again, this is a movie with, like, there really aren't, like, villains, you know? The villain is our, the villain is humanity, right? It's like this, it's this weird kind of, like, Oliver Stone sort of like, oh, the villain's the system, man. Like, and who's behind it? Us. We're operating the machinery of our own death. It's odd.
Yeah, man. The villain is our own paranoia. Anyway, hey, Rob Krekel, where can we get more of your beautiful, beautiful face?
You can follow me on Twitter. It's at Rob Krekel, R-O-B-K-R-E-K-E-L. And I'm going to just steal a little tiny bit of Diamond Time. If you guys are interested in sound effects that I have made with the fine folks over at Film Riot, you can go to triunestore.com, and there are very frequent sales. So you can pick up some cool punch sound effects, some gun sound effects and stuff that I've made with those guys. More to be coming, hopefully this year.
Dude, that was the first time I met you live and in person, was while somebody was shooting like machine guns and stuff. And you were recording that, right?
That's true. Yeah, it's the first time we met in person.
Let me just say this. Rob is, again, like a awesome, awesome, awesome professional at what he does. Working with the guys at Triune and Ryan and everybody there, you guys did world-class stuff. If you are interested in any way at doing anything in terms of video stuff, just don't even hesitate. Pick that up. You never know when you're going to use it.
Man, is it just me or was this like a hell of an episode?
Man, I don't know. I mean, I kind of feel, I was trying to think of a joke that involved beef eaters. Between the queef thing and like.
Well, no.
I just wanted to let you know I was working on it and I failed. You know, it was pencils down on
the queef eaters.
Queef eaters, fire!
Oh, hot damn. Dude, every Tuesday night, it's like a miracle dream come true. Hanging out with my best friends in the universe. You guys are the best people on the planet. Justin, I'm so thrilled that our live event went so well. Rob, I'm so thrilled you were able to make it out. And I find it an honor that I got to hang out you on the eve of finding out about the amazing critical success of your latest endeavor. Congratulations, man.
Thanks. Thanks, man.
Justin?
Yeah.
Sticker packs? Stickers or DIAF?
Stickers or DIAF, folks. Man, thank you to everybody in Diamond Club. Man, we have sold a ton of these. So I've had a reorder twice already in like the 5 days that we've done it. But go ahead and check it out. Stickers or DIAF.com. $5 for your sticker pack. Go ahead and get it now.
Heck yeah, man. Do me a favor, beautiful people. Die in a fire. That I
See you next warm Tuesday. Glass of Drano.
Night attack. 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 I love you.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.
Y'all be sure and answer your doors tomorrow so you can get those papers that are being served. Papers. Yeah.
Listen, by the way, I'm just going to let you know that sidling up to the bar with a purpose right now is my lovely wife, Ashley Paramore. Like, she just put down her wine glass and just, like, put her foot up literally on our little table here and is now looking at me as if she's got a story to tell. How'd you think the show went, honey?
It went great. You act like you've never heard a queef in your life. You are a really bad queefer.
No, I'm like, we're doing a bit about queefing. What am I like, gonna do? Like, well, as the foremost resident expert on queefing, I do hereby.
I've heard a queef or two in my time.
Your microphone is off. Well,
never mind.
What?
Brian started a whole bit with.
I was doing a whole bit.
It would have been great.
It would have been great.
Still a great night.
Is this what I think it is over here?
Yeah.
It's 8 to 10 different belt dishes.
But that's not what that is. That's from Tryon. Here we go.
What is my correct? This is nice and wet.
See?
Please put that at the end of the episode.
Yes, please.
Take a note.